spreading the word to the people who needed to hear. Oh, I readily did accept Muhammad's message from God. Abu Bakr al-Siddique, the Prophet's faithful friend, trusted and protected him, his love had no end. Abu Bakr al-Siddique, Allah be pleased with him, companion in Jannah, oh blessed by Allah. Abu Bakr al-Siddique.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله. Brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And welcome again to Righteous Companions. This is the sixth episode talking about the second of the two, the Prophet's faithful friend Abi Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. And this is the last episode, brothers and sisters in Islam. The last episode we talked about the big fitna that faced the Ummah. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu made a statement that one of the most devastating fitna that faced the Muslims right after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the ridda. The Siddiq radiyallahu anhu was the man for the mission. I cannot go by without bringing that statement that he made when he was debating with Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, the ground in which he must fight those who stopped paying the zakah. And he explained to him the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we know that Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu was the most knowledgeable of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hadith and statements, because he was so dear to him. Brothers and sisters in Islam, one of the things that Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu said to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, and subhanallah, I'm just amazed, Umar radiyallahu anhu, who always was known throughout his mission after he became a Muslim to be tough and strong, when he was asked about what should we do with the prisoners right after the Battle of Badr, he said, let's kill them. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, the compassionate, the merciful, he said, no, let's, you know, make them a favor, ask for a ransom and have them go back, and that would be a good cause of da'wah. It's flipped the other way around. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu insisting, and Umar's trying to drive Abu Bakr al-Siddiq away from doing that, because Abu Bakr al-Siddiq is the leader then. Umar is the second man. This is the caliber of that generation. And some of the statements that Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu made to Umar ibn al-Khattab, he said, أَشَدِيدٌ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. You were severe in jahiliyyah before Islam. And now, أَنْتَ لَيِّن فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. You are lenient in Islam. I'm seeking your help and support, and now you're trying to drive me away from doing something that we must do, we must handle. Ya Umar, لقد مات النبي. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is dead. وانقطع الوحي. And the revelation is done. واكتمل الدين. And the deen is complete. أو ينقص عندي يا عمر. أو ينقص الدين وأنا حي يا عمر. Ya Allah, if each one of us takes the deen as serious as Abu Bakr al-Siddiq did, do you want the deen to decrease when I'm alive, O Umar? You want Islam to be harmed when I'm alive, O Umar? No, O Umar. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu insisted, brothers and sisters in Islam, and he sent the armies of the Muslims all over the land in order to bring Muslims back to Islam. And he always given them this nasiha. Even so, it was mentioned in the context of the army of Osama that was sent out to the tribes of Quda'a at the borders with the Roman Empire. He always said this to them, لا تغدروا, do not betray, لا تخونوا, do not kill children, do not kill elders, do not kill women, do not cut down trees, do not kill animals, but for the sake of eating, do not burn trees, burn trees in particular, do not. You may see people isolated and secluded in sanctuaries in the desert, worshipping Allah, do not come near them. This is the caliber. He wanted to make sure that these are the advices that the Prophet ﷺ always used to give to the leader of the armies before they march out. These are the rules of engagement in Islam, brothers and sisters in Islam. And always before you fight people, give them the option for peace. This is the caliber of this religion, brothers and sisters in Islam. But we know sometimes, like Uthman ibn Affan, radiyallahu anhu, said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَزَعُ بِالسُّلْطَانِ مَا لَا يَزَعُ بِالْقُرْآنِ. Sometimes you need power in order to maintain the da'wah, in order to maintain Islam. The Quran, there are some people who would not believe, so you have to stop them. Brothers and sisters in Islam, in the fighting with those fake prophets and their followers, in particular, in a battle called al-Yamama, the battle that basically Khalid ibn al-Walid, radiallahu anhu, was the general, the ruler, the army general, the Muslim army's general at the time, and they were fighting Musaylimah al-Kadhab, Musaylimah the liar, and his followers from al-Yamama. Again, someone who claimed that he's a prophet. Even his people, they knew that he's a fake prophet. But because of the nationalism, he's from our tribe, he's from our land, let's support him. They fought the Muslims, and the Muslims fought them in a severe battle called al-Yamama. In this battle, brothers and sisters in Islam, 700 of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who used to memorize the Quran, Qurra'ul Quran, or Huffadul Quran, died. They were killed in this battle. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu an, upon hearing this, he became so alarmed. And he came to Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu an, and he said to him, Ya Khalifata Rasulillah, the vicegerent after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, rescue the Quran. The companions who are well known in the Muslim Ummah to be the reciters and the memorizers of the Quran were killed. A lot of them were killed in this battle. I'm afraid, let's collect the Quran. And we know at this very time, brothers and sisters in Islam, the Quran was written but scattered places and scattered materials, skins of animals and leaves of trees and so forth. But at the same time, the Quran was also kept in the memory of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu an became concerned that what happened if all those who memorized the Quran would die. Then he came to Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, and then Abu Bakr al-Siddiq stopped. He said, how you're asking me to do something that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not do? And he would not go for it. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu kept asking him over and over and over again until Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sharaha sadrahu lil-amr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala basically inspired him in a way that he became, but he did not receive revelation. Let's be careful now. The revelation was buried with the Prophet ﷺ, that he agreed, and he called upon Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu, called to Abi Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Abi Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu said to him, Ya Zayd, innaka shab, you're a young man, you're a youth, aqil, and you have wisdom, and we do not have any doubt regarding your credibility. Go after the Quran and collect it. Look at the reaction of Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu. He said, Wallahi, by Allah, if they would have asked me to move a mountain from one place to another, it would have been easier for me than collecting the Quran. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported him, and he collected all the Quran, and he established a rule that he would not compile any verse without seeing it written and having two witnesses who memorized that verse. With this, brothers and sisters in Islam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq did another wonderful mission that the Ummah was so in much in need for, was so in need for, which is compiling and collecting the Quran in one book. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq giving to the Ummah, the giving of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu to the Ummah in a year, a record time, 2.5 years after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, did not stop at this. There is one more thing that he did, and it was the best thing that he did, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and that was right before his death. Let's take a short break and come back and find out what was that thing. Till then, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I really did accept Muhammad's message from God.
Oh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose whom He wills subhanahu wa ta'ala for His mercy, for His messengership, for the revelation to be revealed. This is not for the human beings to make that decision. If a person would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely, truthfully, asking for forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised to forgive. We have as Muslims a duty, and that is to recite the book of Allah, to ponder over the verses, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to act according to the Quran. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything, but it who with our life without getting to know every verse in the Quran, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us.
I really did accept Muhammad's message from God. Muhammad's message from God.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters in Islam, here is the faithful companion, the faithful friend of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the second of the two, becoming ill. His life is about to end. Aisha radiallahu anha narrated this in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, and she said, one day my father took a bath, and after that he became so ill. And here he is, the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, laying down in the bed, and yet he is not concerned about his end. He's not concerned about his illness, I mean. Rather, he is still concerned about the Ummah and what will happen to the Ummah after him. And him experiencing what happened immediately after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the incident of Thaqifat Bani Sa'ida, the one that we cited to you in the last episodes. Some of the scholars said, كانت فلتة. It was something that Allah granted the Ummah, something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spared the Ummah from. And there is a fitna always, brothers and sisters in Islam, once it comes to chairs, once it comes to powers, once it comes to leadership. A lot of people are deceived by this fitna, for your information. Look at our centers back in America and Europe, filled with fitna once it comes to the chairs. People want to be in the leadership position, but they are not qualified to. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he would not, and especially once the seat is empty, a lot of people who do not qualify want to go and jump for it. And this is where Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anh decided to take responsibility of choosing someone before he leaves this world. Radiallahu anhu, he made a statement, and the statement is compiled in Mustadrak al-Imam al-Hakim rahimahullah. He said this, أَفْرَسُ النَّاسِ ثَلَاثِ. There are three individuals who had a very good insight. Al-Farasa, that you make a decision that was excellent. The first one was Shu'ayb, was basically the man, even so the books of Tafsir does not say Shu'ayb, but the man who asked Prophet Musa to marry his daughter. This is one. Again, I want to refute that and say it was not Shu'ayb, but it was the righteous, Ar-Rajul As-Salih. That is the wording in the hadith. The righteous man who asked Musa to marry one of his daughters. إِنِّي أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُنْكِحَكَ إِحْدَى بْنَتَيَّ هَاتَيْنِ. I want you to marry one of my daughters. And the second one is Al-Aziz, the one where Prophet Yusuf was sold to in slavery, when he said to his wife, take care of him, عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَنْفَعَنَا أَوْ نَتَّخِذَهُ وَلَدًا. He may benefit us one day, or he may become our son. And the third one was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, when he chose Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu to be the leader of the ummah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu going through his final illness, he called Abu Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu وقال له, and he said to him, O Uthman, write this book and take it out to the Muslims and have them give the bay'ah, give the pledge to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu before my death. And he told him what to write. This is from Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu as he is leaving this world and approaching his next life. I have chosen Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu to be in my position, to be the leader of the Muslim after me. Support him and give him the bay'ah, brothers, and give him the pledge. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu wrote that book, and then he took it out to the Muslims outside, and all of them given the bay'ah, given the pledge to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was still alive. Then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu called Abu Umar ibn al-Khattab to give him the final wasiyah, his final will. Ya Umar, ittaqillah. O Umar, fear Allah in the ummah. O Umar, take care of the weak. O Umar, be careful. O Umar, with that position, it is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one day, brothers and sisters in Islam, it tells Aisha radiallahu anha, ya bunayati, my daughter, if I die today, do not delay me. Do not delay my burial. I would rather be with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My friend, do not delay my burial. Bury me right away, because I want to be with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he fainted. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu an fainted. And as he was going through the agonies of death, and after he fainted and he gained his conscious again, and Aisha radiallahu anha, seeing her father dying, after seeing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before dying and going through the agonies of death, and she has made a statement that after I have seen the severity of the agonies of death on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I would not feel any bad anymore to see someone else experiencing agonies of death, because of the amount of severity the agonies of death was on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even so, that is her father, when she saw him radiallahu anhu, his soul leaving his body, then she cited this poem and she said, لعمرك لا يغني الثراء عن الفتى إذا حشرجت يوما وضاق بها الصدر. The meaning of which, what riches will do for you? What this will help you? What the whole dunya will help you, brothers and sisters in Islam? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu looks at his daughter and he tells her, Ya bunayati, my daughter, do not say that. I rather would like you to say, I would rather hear you saying, وَجَاءَتْ سَكْرَةُ الْمَوْتِ بِالْحَقِّ ذَلِكَ مَا كُنْتَ مِنْهُ تَحِيدُ. And death brought to you the agonies. The agonies of death brought you the truth. The truth that you will die, whether you are rich or poor. The truth that you will die, even if you are Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. The truth that you will die, even if you are Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised the manners of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Quran. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You have the best character, O Muhammad. And yet he told him, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتْ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. You will die. So the agonies of death brings the truth to each one of us that you will die. Whether you are a president, whether you are a janitor, whether you are jobless, whether you are rich, whether you are poor, the agonies of death will bring the truth to you that you will die. And when you will die, brothers and sisters in Islam, angels of mercy or angels of punishment will be present at the scene. And when you will die, brothers and sisters in Islam, your grave will be one of two. Whether a garden from paradise or a bed from the beds of the hellfire. And when you die, brothers and sisters in Islam, whether you're going to be in Jannah or your lives, brothers and sisters in Islam. When you get sick, you rush to the doctor. When you become hungry, you go to eat. When you become thirsty, you drink because you don't want to die. But when the agonies of death is here, when your time is up, it is over. Brothers and sisters in Islam, al-Siddiq, the most truthful, radiyallahu anhu, after a long journey in this world, serving the deen of Allah, accompanying the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is wishing to be with his friend Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he got his wish. He was buried next to him, radiyallahu an Abi Bakr al-Siddiq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with Abi Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu an, Khalifatu Rasulillah and the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thaniya thnain idh huma fil ghar, the second of the two, idh yaqulu li sahibihi la tahzan, when he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, the disbelievers are standing by the door of the cave, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is assuring him security, telling him, do not grieve, inna Allah ma'ana, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. This is Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. In brief, we have not said everything about Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. Wallahi, by Allah, I love you, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will gather us with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu in Jannah. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, he said, Al-mar'u ma' man ahab. You will be in the day of resurrection with those whom you loved. I bear witness that I love Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, and I bear witness that I love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I bear witness